Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, thank you once again for joining us for this latest episode of BBUK Archive. My name is Karl Bimbridge, and joining me as ever, my co-host, Mr. Karl Dutton.
Hello.
And the newest member of our team, Mr. Mitchell Pinder.
Hi.
Thank you very much, Mitchell. Yes, we've been recruiting for a new presenter. Unfortunately, a lot of scheduling on Joe's side, unfortunately, means he doesn't have the time to do as many episodes as what we would have ideally liked. So we did a little bit of a recruiting, went down to a couple of the social media sites, a couple of the fan forums, and thankfully Mitchell was the only person who replied to our emails, so thank you very much for joining us, Mitch.
Oh, wow, sorry, I feel absolutely flat right now.
Yes.
you were the only choice.
So many literally. People, and take that either way that you like. No, I'm happy to be here.
It's fantastic for you to be with us, and maybe just to introduce yourself a little bit to the audience, you can maybe tell us a little bit of your back history, what you loved about the show, what got you into it, etc.
Oh, wow. Well, I'm 19 years old. I'm Mitchell. This is sounding a bit like Alcoholics Anonymous. I'm a Big Brother obsessive, pretty much. It's one of my favourite TV shows on the whole telly. I love watching it. I love reporting about it. I report about it on my site, Tilly Planet. I've previously reported for Total Big Brother, Big Brother 24/7, all those fan sites. And yeah, I'm pretty obsessive over it. And I don't get out much.
Well, I was just going to ask a question. You said you're 19. What was the first one you actually watched when it was on?
Funnily enough, Big Brother 4.
Oh. I'm surprised you stuck around.
I know.
Though luckily, Big Brother 5 the next year would have hooked you, because that was like the best
one.
So.
You see, with Big Brother 4, I didn't watch it obsessively. I watched 4 or 5
episodes. Yeah, that's the thing,
just
I think.
Happened to catch it.
That's the thing I think about this series, is I think it's going to be a very short episode, you'll see at the time. Timeline,
exactly.
Folks.
It's going to be really short, or full of tangents.
Well, yeah, because we're not going to have much to talk about, and also I think the fact is, for me, I can remember this being on, and I saw a couple of episodes of it, because obviously it was after the ones that were really big, 1 and 2 and 3, so everybody was still watching it at this point. But I can remember Tickle, I can remember a couple of things, but I don't remember much about it. And I remember the talk of after this series of, is the show done? Is this it? Is this, has it reached the end of the line? And then of course we'd get the refresh reboot the next year with the evil stuff, and it became, bigger than ever. But this was the one that almost killed it the first time. The original social experiment without any of the wackiness and Big Brother be this evil overlord that punishes people. This was the end of that original format, because it was people got bored with it, because it was a boring series. So
it wasn't like I'm a celebrity because I'm obsessed with that show. It wasn't like that where I slowly got into it. With I'm a Celebrity, I've watched every episode, I've seen every episode twice, and the first series was on when I was like 5 or 6. So I've been involved with reality TV from that young of an age. But with Big Brother, it was only about 6 where it started to get watching it seriously.
Yeah, I've gone back and watched various series just because I wanted to, and re-enjoy them and watch them all again and stuff. And this is not one of the ones that I did. I had no desire to see this again. We'll get into why as we go along.
Well, we're certainly going to be throwing you into the fire today, Mitch, because as we've sort of really hinted massively to everybody, we are going to be talking about Big Brother 4, and it's a series which I think we've all been dreading recovering, because, let's be honest, it's almost infamous these days, Big Brother 4, as being the boring series. It was the dud. It was, as Carl mentioned, very nearly the franchise killer.
Yeah, if it hadn't been for 5 reboots of the series, this would have been it.
Yes, and we would have got our lives back because we wouldn't have talked about the 20 or 30 series that came afterwards.
Oh, it's all right. I've got plenty of other things to waste my life on.
We run 13 Channel 5 series now, aren't we? It's going way too fast, and I'm starting to realise my life's just slipping away slowly. But I am sort of excited with Big Brother 4 because I do have some facts and figures and stuff, so it should be.
And you never know. Maybe like a fine wine or Carol Vorderman. It's got better with the age and we can come to appreciate some aspects of it.
What, you mean the part where they're reading a book? No. There was a reason they banned those after this.
I mean, let's just say the book they released, there was a whole page purely on pasta bake.
Oh, well, that was a fascinating series. Next year you had Fight Night, this year you had Pasta Bake.
This year's going to get interesting. I've took a bit of research time last night, which was basically a 2.5 Skype conversation with a friend who has the book. And we went through it and...
He has a Big Brother 4 notes, book. There is a book on this series.
He got it for 99p off Amazon. What? Yeah, that's when Big Brother merchandise was selling.
Okay, so does it give you a step by step guide to each episode? And
well, let's just say it was a lot of pages, and it pretty much just gives you what happened, and that we skipped through it very quickly because, to be honest, if I was standing there for about a day reading this book, I think I would have actually ended up dying from boredom.
I remember the highlight of this show, of this series being, the only thing I can remember of this series really, is obviously Cameron going across to Africa, which we'll get to. The other thing I remember is John Tickle talking about the Star Wars Expanded Universe, and that's the most I can remember about this.
Well, maybe we'll...
I will hide my love for John Tickle until later on.
Well, maybe we'll be able to reinvigorate your mind, Carl, as we talk about it. Because first of all, we're going to be starting off with some of the pre-show stuff about that series, and... We sort of touched on it a little earlier before, but we have to talk about the status of Big Brother as a franchise prior to this series, because Big Brother 3 had just happened, and I mean, it exploded. I mean, Big Brother 3 was everywhere. I mean, average ratings of each episode was about 6 million an episode. I mean, you had Dustin Hoffman doing impressions of Johnny Regan on the Graham Norton show, Jade Goody got popular, Alex Sibley was advertising Flash detergent. So the show was massive, and there was a lot of hype going into Big Brother 4 over what the show could provide afterwards. And part of me wonders maybe whether the backlash against Big Brother 4 was partly due to the fact it followed immediately after 3.
Well, I think this is the series that got the most... or 3 was the biggest series that made the most stars in the sense of, you know, people getting jobs afterwards, definitely. And I think... I've heard that apparently the thing for the producers on this series was they wanted a calmer one because of all the drama that went down with the whole wall divide thing, and all the stuff that happened there, which I can't understand. The producers, their mindset was, we just had the best series we've ever done, the highest ratings, so let's do the complete opposite.
But then again, you can maybe argue that part of that was because the show was still in its social... experiment stage.
Yeah, at this point it was still almost pure, whereas again, as I've mentioned before, I think the next year, why it got a hell of a lot more entertaining as a result, the next year is when the show became much more manipulative and much more about let's get some freaks in there and look at the freaks go wild kind of thing.
Well, no, I totally agree with that point. I mean, when you're looking back at Big Brother 3, you had so many people getting jobs out of it. You had Johnny, who's been appearing on many things. Obviously, Jay Goody, she's Jay Goody. You've got Alison Hammond, who is still prominent on TV these days. I mean, she was signed up for Strictly last year, which is seen as the more upper-class reality show. And you've got Adele Roberts, who is now the new early breakfast host on Radio 1. So you've got all these people that are actually still working regularly. And I think it's excellent that we're finally getting, I don't know where I'm going with this one.
Well, if you're going to say we're finally getting recognition, when you say finally, you mean 13 years ago, but yes. 13 years ago, it was huge. Nowadays, they're lucky if they get a Channel 5 scratch advert, and that's if they've been on the celebrity one.
Poor Kelly Maloney, but with Big Brother 4, all you can really say is... we had John Tickle on Brainiac. That's pretty much all that happened. you've now got Cameron Stout, who would probably cut off his right leg for a TV appearance these days.
Just think, all the people who went into this series thought they were going to become as big as Goody and no.
When actually they're not really as big as Peter from the Fish and Chip Shop.
Yeah.
And on that note, we sort of have to talk about the cast, because, let's be honest, these are people who we're going to absolutely get frustrated to hell with when we do this podcast. But that first 12 people there, what were your first opinions when you saw them for the first time? Did you think that it was a calmer group, did you? Because I wasn't really excited by anybody when I saw that launch night, but I thought they seemed pleasant enough people, and they were people who I wanted to know more about. And I think maybe that was the intention of the show at that point, but where did you stand on the launch night cast? Who were the standouts for you?
Well, John, definitely Cameron, Noosh, quite a few of them seem very interesting. But talking about the casting, I've actually got some casting stats here. Oh. When they were auditioning, they had 10,102 applicants. And then they went into detail about the sexuality as well. There were 7,149 straight people, 1,092 gay people, 704 bisexual people, and 647 who didn't tell them. When you look at that, those stats, 10,000 applied in its prime.
It just shows.
Imagine how many people are applying now.
Well, I don't think any of them are applying because they're all recruited.
Well, no, people are applying. They're just applying over like YouTube now.
I mean, 10,000 isn't as much as I personally expected, considering it was early in its prime. Considering X Factor gets 100,000 applicants a year, you would have thought in its prime Big Brother would have been getting a lot more. But nowadays, I think the straight and gay ratio has probably changed, because you can imagine a lot more. I think you could swap them around pretty much nowadays.
Yeah, I think maybe that the of course at this point they weren't doing the recruiting thing, which is another thing that some people, or at least as far as I know, they weren't doing the recruiting thing, which is another thing that people grind their gears about what happened after this series. But again, it gave us more entertaining people, so, you know, you can't really argue when the results worked. But yeah, this was when they were still getting, you know, normal people, and they were still a social experiment. And I think this, again, it was the death of that concept. Maybe there was less applicants because people thought, you know, obviously the last year's cast suffered a bit more. I mean, not as much as they would in later series, but they did more stuff to them. Maybe people just, you know, X Factor or something like that, all you've got to do is sing, really. You're not going to be starved.
And endure Cheryl Cole.
That true.
Yeah. But on that launch then, we get our first 12 people, which of course seem perfectly pleasant, nice enough to all of us. And then we get the first big twist of the season. Now, this was, I think this was really like the first time we ever had a proper launch night twist. And now that's almost commonplace in this day and age, but this one is quite controversial. I think a lot of people point to the downfall of BBUK4 right from this moment, and that's first night nominations.
It was a cool new thing. It was a new concept. I haven't got a problem with them for trying it,
but I think in the long term, definitely though, I think if it sounds good on paper, the idea of having to nominate and potentially evict someone based on your first impressions, but when put into practice and applied to a show such as this, where you need to grow and you need to know, you need to get a better understanding of people, it just completely backfires. We're basically having to choose to get rid of one of the biggest characters of the show on the back of knowing people for 2 hours.
True.
Yeah.
But I will say this, if your show relies on one cast member to carry the whole thing, you haven't done a good job of casting.
They've recently done that over in Big Brother Canada, first night nominations. First episode anyway. And it didn't really work over there.
I think it works better for that version of the series because it's more of a tactical game, whereas this involves the public judging on people's personality and social stuff, whereas that is purely about tactics, and tactics don't change whether it's... True. I guess it'll be the same then. Ignore what I just said.
Because you would make the argument that the two people who really stood out on that launch night were Anushka and John. And yet who were the two people who ended up getting the most nominations, and two of the four people who were nominated that week? Anushka and John.
Because they stood out. It's, you know, social 101.
So, yes, Anushka ends up getting the most nominations. I think she ends up getting about 6 nominations. John ends up with 4, and Federico and Scott both receive 1 nomination each. And I think that's the only time Scott has ever nominated during the season.
I think that was a huge mistake, putting big names on the line that easily.
Yes.
And I think if Anushka had stayed, it would have been a lot better.
Well, this is before they invented. Well, this is before they invented the whole go into a secret room that we now get every series.
Anushka would be put in a secret room if this happened in BBUK 15.
Well, she'd be put into 3 secret rooms. 3 of these people would have been evicted and put into secret rooms if it happened these days.
The worst thing is, I am actually imagining that in my head, and it probably would actually happen. It's not even an exaggeration in any way. The thing that I also realised with the launch night cast is they seemed a fun bunch at first. I mean, they all, 4 of them, tried to get on the diary room chair and then broke it. And it had just been unveiled that night, and they broke it within the first night. And they seemed a really fun cast, but I think the nominations really did not help.
And I remember as well that the next 3 days, whilst they were repairing the chair behind the scenes, for the next 3 days, you just had this tiny little stool for them to sit on. So we go on to week 1. We've already had our nominees. We go on to week 1. And we go on to... I think if there is one thing to really praise Big Brother 4-4, I think the quality of the tasks, especially compared to Channel 5 era Big Brother, the quality of the tasks was so much better. And the one that comes to mind for me is the week 1 one, which was the pedalo task.
Yeah, 72 hours, wasn't it?
72 hours you had to keep a pedalo going for, I think it was like 40 rotations a second, something like that. And you had to make sure one person was on at all times. And I mean, could you imagine like Ash or Winston doing that these days?
I mean, they've done a lot of tasks like that since, but it sounds like this was the harshest, most real, you know, they made sure that the rules were kept to. Nowadays, it'd be like, oh, you have to do it for like 2 hours, and there'd be 2 hours of people going, oh my God, it's so hard.
With a huge cycling hat on.
Yeah, and montage music and lens flares, don't forget those.
Yes.
Oh yeah, totally. And the housemates then complain, and there be a fight, and then they provide them with alcohol and all sorts. But I do think that the whole pedalo task was a good idea, and I would be open to actually see some endurance tasks rather than just sitting there for 5 hours and then it being over.
Definitely. But after all those 72 hours though, what happens at the end of the task? They've gone tooth and nail, they've slogged it out to try and get all those 72 hours, they failed it because Federico screwed up. It starts us onto one of the themes of the season during those early weeks, which was Federico's consistent failure of the tasks.
Okay.
Or Federico completely failing the whole series.
And again, I hate to keep drawing comparisons, but that would not happen these days. It would have been so much easier. They would have done it, you know. But back then, you actually...
But they all would have jumped around in a circle.
If you actually failed, you failed. Not, oh, you're going to get it as a consolation prize. No, you failed. You lose.
Here's a takeaway.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
I think what's interesting with Big Brother 4 is there's so many comparisons to be made about what would happen these days. And I think they did try out a lot of stuff which we've got these days, despite the fact
that... Yeah, it's a great comparison because you're saying, like, okay, so... People who, you know, it's both sides of the argument. It's people who say, okay, you know, these days is too flashy, the rules are never followed, it's just based on the producer's whims, and, you know, it's just, you know, providing entertainment value on short term, night to night. Whereas the other version is sticking to the rules, social experiment, proper serious business, and people see that as boring. So it's kind of like you have the two extremes of what this show can be. And I think for most of us as fans, we like it somewhere in the middle. And
yes.
I think that, this show gives the extreme of like, okay, if they were just purely what the show was when it was invented, this is what the show would be, and nobody would watch it.
I mean, we're almost. I mean, the book states that Big Brother was a record-breaking start. Imagine probably a record-breaking end as well. Least watched series. Well, it's not the least watched because look at us.
No,
a lot of people tuned in. We had a main show average of 4.8 million and 1.5 for watching Little Brother, which is odd considering
we get 1.5 for the main show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And also, you can tell the public did like The Housemates because 150, I hate to bring up Deef Evil, but 150,000 people watched the live feed on E4 during the daytime, and in the evening it was 180,000 people on the first week watched the feed on E4.
Just a sign of how big the show was at that point.
Yeah, even when nothing,
just sit there for hours.
Even when nothing was happening and the show was boring, people still watched this stuff.
I stand corrected to you on that because on week one we got John singing Hotel California.
Oh.
That, I mean, that's pretty much the highlight of the whole series, isn't it? Did he do the full version or just the shorter version?
I think it was just the shorter version, but I remember him washing the vegetables. Back in the days when we had vegetables, you had to grow their own fruit and veg. He was spraying the vegetables and he was just singing, "We were all just prisoners here of our own device," and that became massive. Like, people were like really saying, like, John Tickle, like, he's a legend. He's, we should release Hotel California when he comes out the house, stuff like that. It's just, again, it was how big the show was at that point.
It would be one of those videos.
And again, comparisons,
wouldn't it?
Comparisons to these days, when we had the vegetable patch, we got the vegetable patch back, and they just didn't use it. They just said, "Yeah, it's just there for show." Come Celebrity Big Brother, it was gone like that. They literally lasted about 2 days of saying, "Yeah, you've got to grow your own cucumbers." And then they just wimped out with it.
Yeah. Look, folks, we're stretching. It's this series, so we're trying to get in all these bitching about the modern era. Plus, Mitchell hasn't ever been on to bitch about the modern era. If you've ever heard the other shows, all I do is bitch about the modern era. So I'm glad somebody else is here to do it as well.
Yes. We'll move on then, and we'll move on to that first eviction. Of course, it's Anushka, Fed, John, and Scott who have been nominated. Now, I noticed as well, especially because I sort of dabbled on the forums around that point, but I do remember a lot of people really beginning to warm to Anushka as the week went on. I think the consensus was a lot of people were really unanimously, "We want Anushka gone," based on launch night. But as the series went on and we saw that she was entertaining, she was quirky, she seemed likable enough, that really began to switch. And I would argue that Federico was the big one that people were trying to push for by the end of the week. But of course, it ends up being too late, and Anushka ends up going in what was one of the big mistakes of that series. What did you make of that?
I mean, I think that she should have stayed. I mean, Federico, yeah, he was her housemate. That's about as far as I can go with him. But on day 10, he got his formal warning about inappropriate, crude behaviour.
I'm glad you're here with these facts. Anushka, I don't remember any of this.
I know this, but this book is literally just a lifesaver. Otherwise, I would have literally been sitting here.
Oh no, it's great.
Just
great.
This is
the equivalent of doing a movie review and just reading off IMDb because we haven't watched the movie.
pretty much. I think that series needs to happen now.
Yes.
And what did we make of Anushka? Did we enjoy her? Did we find her likeable enough? What was our opinions?
She had a personality, so she had to go, says the public.
Exactly. Famous last words.
And it's a real crying shame as well, because I remember Anushka actually went into the Australian version straight afterwards. She was like a guest there. And you saw some of the clips that, because I think she was on BBLB after she went in. She came back and you saw clips of the Australian BB and we were just like, Why are the Australians getting this? What the hell happened here? We could have had Anushka doing all that in our house.
And also, that was the year that the Australians actually built another separate house and had two houses. And yeah, they had a good year that year.
Yeah, Dullness. And we had.
You see, I'd love to have that, but we're never getting that.
Not now!
The first we get is the safe house.
six or seven years ago, maybe. Nowadays, we'll be lucky if we get one main house built properly and looking good without it falling down.
I'm surprised we haven't had another Big Brother 11 yet with the floods.
Yeah. Just from some stiff wind because they didn't have the money to build a good enough wall.
We do. Well, we do. Although we do get something very similar that also requires a house evacuation. We'll get onto that later. As we move on to week two, one of the very few things of Big Brother 4 that I would actually like to see back in the modern series, and that's the reward room. There would always be some sort of Saturday night tasks. It would always be something quite light and funny. And the winners would always get some sort of reward room. And I think on week one, it was a disco. And then, of course, they'd have, like, party rooms and all that sort of stuff. And, yeah, you could argue a lot of that happens today. But a flat-out award room was something quite novel then. And it's something I really enjoyed as well. Because there was all these secrets as well that you had to, like, push certain blocks to actually get access to the room. I found that quite quirky when I was the young, naive self.
I was quite excited for Secrets and Lies because they said what hides behind the doors. And I was thinking something similar. There'd be all sorts of secrets going around rather than, yeah, you've got a safe house and a pool. I mean, I would have loved something like the reward rooms and just having all these different elements adding to it slowly.
Yeah, it sounds good. Yeah, it sounds good. I mean, the Australians took this concept and ran with it a couple of years later. They had the whole Friday night games thing. Unfortunately, once again, there are some great points of our series, and I think our series can be the best one sometimes, but sometimes when we invent a concept, somebody takes it and does it so much better. It sounds like this is a fun idea. Shame we just didn't have entertaining people doing it, I guess.
Also that week we had Federico's second fail. We had the Cub Scout task, and I think all the housemates had to remember this long oath off by heart. Everybody managed to get it right except Federico.
Federico.
Do you think Federico did it deliberately? Do you think he was deliberately trying to fail?
Oh no, of course not.
Who would ever do that?
It's like, yes, we've been doing this for 72 hours. I'm now going to make us starve. No.
I'd probably end up doing that if I was in that house.
Exactly. People make honest mistakes. It just so happens to be the same guy.
And on that subject of Federico as well, we got probably one of the very few controversial moments of that season. And it stems from a sort of recurring joke that Federico always used to, which was he's flirting with Big Brother.
Huh.
Because I always remember he would always come into the diary room, and it was sort of like this sort of cross between Austin Powers and Avid Miriam from Ball Selector. He'd come into the diary room and he'd be like, "Hello, big lover, you're looking so sexy." It was so funny.
Was this not when the voice was very sort of robotic as well?
Yes, which made it even funnier. Because I think Big Brother these days, when they do use the actual voice, it's very humanistic.
Yeah, they're just talking the normal voice, like the producers are just chatting to them. Whereas back here, they had this kind of like cold, emotionless voice where they spoke very monotone.
Yeah. You see, that's what I've really enjoyed in recent series is when a housemate goes that extra mile with Big Brother. And I remember Big Brother laughing at, was it Alex Sibley? And I mean, obviously that's not recent, but I like watching that rather than, I think that's what I'm missing is the fun element of Big Brother in the recent series, is that all they seem to air is just bitching. I mean, all we saw in January, I mean, as much as January was one of my favourite series ever, there was no task whatsoever. They edited out all the tasks just because Perez did something else, Casey Hopkins did something else. Why can't we have a bit of the fun element back? I think a lot of people are missing it.
Strangely enough, though, like, all Federico's flirting was considered too crude, and that's what resulted to his warning, which I think maybe it's because I look at it in sort of, like, rose-tinted glasses and with the comparisons to the modern series, but you listen to what he said, it wasn't overtly awful.
But saying that, we live in a series when 14 warnings for Helen isn't enough to get her kicked out. So, I think these days, flirting, I think you could go into a lot of detail and still not reach Federico standard.
Yes. The other two big names who were involved in that series were also John and Justy. Now, John had really made himself to a target of the majority of the house because he was nominated every week until he actually went. Which sort of confused me because it wasn't that he was a confrontation, it wasn't that he was argumentative, he was just annoying. And yet the house hated him for that.
At the end of the day, this show tells you to find a flaw in somebody and vote them out, basically. And of course, if you know, a minor thing has become big things because of it, so.
Yes. But it was a one.
Yeah, let's eliminate the two people that are making the series in the first 2 weeks.
Oh, don't worry,
I'm glad we've
But it's the old argument of, you know, it's fun to watch, but you wouldn't want to live with them kind of thing. You know, that's why they they're usually the
Frenchy.
Opposite. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But of course, John is one of the people nominated that week alongside Justine, and it's Justine who ends up being evicted that week. 57% of the vote to go, so it was quite a close eviction. But it leads us to one of the problems because I honestly cannot think of anything to say about Justine Selman.
I'd love to tell you I have an opinion, but I don't even know who that is.
I mean, honestly, I'm really struggling here. And if there is a Justine fan, we'd love to hear them on comments.
Tell us why they were amazing and why they should have been in the Ultimate Series.
Shall I send out a tweet? Shall I send out a tweet and see if we can get any Justine Selman fans? By the way, that's a very lovely pun because we now have Twitter on Big R.
Yes, you can see it on our Twitter.
Good.
We're already followed by quite a few housemates, although that's pretty much just Mark and Jack and Joe. But
look,
I think
it's a start.
Yes,
I know it's
and
a start.
And to
we're
those
gonna
people,
get there. I'm gonna tweet and see if we can get any.
And to those people, I apologise. I hated your series, but you know.
Yes. Thank you for subscribing.
Yes.
If there is one thing I do.
Let's mention this. What shall my tweet be? Any Justine Selman fans, please make yourself known now.
Or any fans of anybody in Big Brother 4 other than John Tickle. and anybody else. Just let us know.
If there is one thing I do remember on that sort of subject, though, I run the Big Brother attractiveness ranking every year on Digital Spy. And I remember last year, there was one bloke who was absolutely insistent that Justine was the most attractive Big Brother housemate ever. Justine finishes about like 114th place, something like that, but he's insisted that she should have been higher.
Each to their own. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder, as they say.
And that's all I can really say about Justine. I've got a feeling this is going to be one of the themes with Big Brother 4 when we talk about the housemates. But we move on to week 3, and we move on to the third Federico fail, which comes in a bell-ringing task.
You wonder why we're going off on bitching tangents. This is why. We don't remember this series, and what we do, we don't remember it fondly. Okay? Sorry.
That's why we're spending 5 minutes sending a tweet.
Yes. But we're trying to get somebody on who does remember this series. There's got to be one person out there who thinks this was the best series ever.
Cameron.
For me? I think he even admits that it wasn't very good. I think he probably went to the Africa.
He has on Digital Spy. On Digital Spy, I swear he said it before that he really didn't like it.
Yeah.
I mean, later on in the show, give me a minute and I'll do a montage of funny things that it says in the book, which shows how interesting that series is. But I think that says a lot when we can't mention anything about a task where we've just totally, it's gone from our minds.
Definitely. Yeah,
again, this is one of the ones where the ones all around this series I watched feverishly. This one, don't remember a darn thing about it other than a couple of things. I watched it probably every couple of weeks. and I have no desire to go back and watch it again. So there's got to be somebody out there who would for us, but we're doing our best, folks. We've got our book, okay? We're going to follow the book.
Do you remember another big controversy involving Federico and his comments about women from Newcastle?
No.
No, but I think you're going to tell us.
Yes, I do. Which was basically they were having conversations about women from different areas of the country. And Federico made the assessment that all women from Newcastle were slags. And it was a massive big backlash from it, especially from the northeast of England where I'm from. A lot of people really turning against Federico and basically being for his blood on the back of that.
Yeah. Federico, imagine if someone said that these days, it would just be classed as normal. I think it would just be something that would be coming out of Helen's mouth these days.
I'm looking at the housemates page of this year, and it's barely one paragraph per person. Like, that's how much people have to... Somebody has two lines.
I think Nush only has one.
Yeah, oh, Jesus Christ. Like, usually these things...
And she lasted almost the whole series.
When you go on every other series, there's, like, paragraphs of people telling you what happened to that person in that series. This one says it all, really.
We move on from Federico's comments about girls from Newcastle, and we go on to the whole John Tickle phenomenon, which is basically just talking about all those geeky eccentricities about John Tickle, some of those behaviours that maybe agitated a lot of the people in the house, but a lot of those behaviours which endeared him as well. Because you have to remember, John, especially by Big Brother 4 standards, became a really big star of the show.
Yeah, I can remember him telling everybody what happened in the Thrawn trilogy of the expanded Star Wars universe and them all falling asleep. That's what I remember of him.
Are we still on week two?
We're week three now. The thing is as well, though, is when you think about it, especially in today's day and age where you have like the Avengers versus Massive, the Marvel Universe, and the Big Bang Theory is popular, could you imagine how popular a housemate John Tickle would be if he was in a modern series, talking about all these geek-orientated things?
Yep. We have taken over.
We certainly have. And especially as well, we have a superhero task which comes in week four, which links into that as well.
Yep.
Before we get to that, though, we have another eviction. John is once again nominated alongside Federico in City as well. And you'd think, quite surprisingly, considering the result, City is the one that ends up being evicted that week.
Hi, Sissy.
Yeah, the only thing I remember about Sissy was that...
Was his name City?
Sissy.
Right, I thought you meant like C-T-R... wait a second. I'm trying to say C-I-T-Y. City.
He's in Big Brother 16, don't worry.
Oh.
Well, I remember having like this broad Scouse accent... like dark red hair, and I remember as well the young kid I was absolutely giggling me head off that there was a kid called Sissy in there, and that's it. That's all I can remember about Sissy.
You've got a strange name. Good for you.
I was a dumb kid.
Yes.
We'll talk about week four, and we're talking about something which was very unique at the time, probably something we absolutely sick of these days. The first ever double eviction.
Oh my god.
At that point, Big Brother just stopped giving a shit.
No. Quite the opposite. people were actually stopping giving a shit, so this was their ratings grabber. This was their thing to get people back into it. That's the idea.
I think it was pre-planned. I think maybe it's just me being naive and thinking of the innocence of the time. But I think a lot of these tasks, which ended up spoiling the series, were pre-planned. I think they always intended to have a week four double eviction. The one problem was, though, they didn't take into account the dynamics of the show. And they should have realised that, hang on a minute, we've only got a few characters which are carrying the show here. We could easily lose one or both of them in this one week. And that's what happened. It's almost like Big Brother Canada, where we have these great ideas on paper that should be good, but because they don't take into account the dynamics, it ends up spoiling the series as a result, because they don't think it through.
I think you need to plan it in advance, but you need to have it so you can edit it and move it around and just make sure that the series is fine. Because this just proves, I mean, the two that went, they shouldn't have gone.
I mean,
as much as people disliked her, Federico friend, he added something to the series and like most of that series.
The moment they realised it was Cameron, Fed and John, they should have just made it a single. Obviously, you're going to lose one of Fed and John, but I'd rather lose one than lose both.
Look, this was back in the day when they said they were going to do something, they did it. So, they didn't lie to us back then. God damn it!
I've got another quote. I've got another quote from the book about John Tickle, about one of his diary room updates. It says, John makes his visit to the diary room. Today he moans about the designers and the engineers. He complains about the design of the kitchen, the position of the plants in the garden, the broken air conditioning, the faulty garden hose, and the very, very uncomfortable diary room chair. And he describes the cameraman as a herd of elephants.
Well, they haven't changed.
Why can't we have someone like that these days? Like, seeing someone sitting there moaning about the designers and the engineers would seriously be just one of those fun elements that we're missing. It frustrates me that they evicted him after doing... Yeah, because as much as, it's not them all dancing to Barbie Girl or whatever, that's yet to come. John, going in there and just having a random rant and moaning about the engineers, and it's just something a bit different. And it shows how John like John was. I probably should have thought about how I was...
No, I get what you're saying. I get what you're saying. It's a different kind of personality.
Yes.
Exactly. It's rather than the ones that were fading into the background in Big Brother 4.
And one of those in those early weeks was Cameron. Now, you'd think, considering he was the winner of the show and how prominent the winners need to be in this modern day and age, what was your opinion of Cameron during that point, at that point? Because he was very under the radar, and I think he was just seen as a genteel, boring bloke. And
he was especially after Africa. Scottish guy.
And especially after he comes back from Africa and we see a real change in his personality, I think it's really quite alarming to actually see just how under the radar he was and how far he came out of the radar after he came back.
I mean, talking about Cameron going to Africa, this is another comparison that I'm going to make to these days. Imagine TIBB and Digital Spy and Twitter, when the producers decide which one's going to get 2 weeks off of nomination and fly all the way to Africa.
There we go.
Oh my God, he's being protected. He's leaving the house. Sacrilege.
imagine that these days. It would kick off.
He's their favourite to win.
They decide.
They picked him.
I know.
It's a fix.
They're being protected. 2 weeks off nominations. No, can't be doing that. Can't be doing that. Send me on a free holiday.
I can safely say, for as much as we could kind of dislike the modern series and the modern series style of doing things, we hate the fans more.
Yeah.
Not all of you. Those of you who are listening to this show.
I love most of the fans. But let's just say I'd probably find these fans discussing this series a bit better than
if you're listening to this show, you're a good fan. But if you're one of those people that stands outside and chants off during somebody's eviction interview, you can F off.
I didn't chant off to anybody's final eviction. I can promise. I mean, yeah. I love the fans, but they can get a bit extreme about producer involvement. There's three things that all the fans like to moan about. The certain ones, certain fans.
Look.
Live feed, producer's interaction, and the ice stage outside.
Yes. Look,
they're the three things that to kick off about every series, and it is excellent to read.
Yes. And I agree with many of their points, and I agree with a lot of what they say, but look, here's the deal. The show was always manipulated by the producers. It's just now they're shit at hiding it.
But even though they didn't hide it, they said, the producers have decided what? And they didn't mind.
I've made this comparison before. I think the fact that back in the day you felt like they were showing you everything and being honest with you, whereas now it feels like they're trying to, like, oh, look over there, that thing's totally not happening on the other direction. Oh, look, when she's walking into that secret room, like, that's totally not a studio, even though we can see the frickin' photography umbrella.
Can we,
And the posters.
Can we get this back on tangent, lads?
To the show that we don't have anything to say about? Okay, yeah, let's go with it.
Yeah, so that's sort of the point of the show, is to talk about the series.
Yes.
Yeah. And we'll talk about, basically, the death knell of Big Brother 4, which was John and Federico's double eviction. And this is really our chance to talk about the two biggest characters of the season, because I've actually got a little bit of a controversial opinion in regards to these two. Now, I have a lot of them when it comes to Big Brother, if you listen to the show, but this is one I really stand by, which is, yes, John Tickle was amazing. And yes, losing John Tickle was a big blow to the show. But in my eyes, losing Federico was the bigger blow, because he was the antagonist. He was the one that was winding people up in a house that needed an antagonistic figure. And I think, yes, John Tickle was entertaining, but you needed Federico to wind people up to create the drama and the conflict. And I noticed it went really, really dull. Not so much because of John, but because we lost Fed. Okay.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think, what is this, week four, did you say?
Week four.
Always happens. Every single year, week four is where we lose the big character and it goes downhill. In good series, we have other characters to keep the show going and prop it up, and they'd have late arrivals, things like that, to bring it back up. But this always happens every single year, except this year they didn't have the characters to come back from it.
No one has currently replied to, did anyone watch Big Brother 4?
Nobody wants to admit
this is fair and well for our podcast, isn't it? How many people are going to be listening to this?
I don't think people want to admit to it. And of course, we've got to bring up the legend that was John Tickle, because John went global after this. He really became a big star out of the show. And of course, Brainiac hired him, and I think originally he was just one of the side characters. He ended up becoming the main presenter. I mean, John really got himself a decent TV career out of Big Brother 4, which is amazing considering the bad rep it got. It was a sign of how big of a character he was.
Yeah, because even though it was known as the boring one, loads of people still watched it. So he was known, and, good for him.
Do you think those...
You see, if we do have the whole... we're going to have housemates back in Time Bomb, then I would very much like John Tickle to be back in that house.
Him and Federico are the only two people who should be considered for Time Bomb from Big Brother 4.
I think anybody from this series would be lost in the modern shows. I think they'd be completely overwhelmed by the kind of characters that would be in there with them.
And it brings me on to another point, which was, do you think that John benefited from having the dull series? Because if he was in Big Brother 3, would he have been as big a character?
No.
Who knows? But maybe not.
And on that, we'll move on to week five, which is the controversial twist, which we sort of touched on, which was Cameron going to Africa. Now, we could talk about whether this helped Cameron and the benefits of going there and whether he was producer's pet, etc., etc. You can't deny, though, that was an amazing twist to see happen. And it's just a sign of how big the show was, that they were doing something like taking a housemate to another Big Brother, which was happening right across the world. I mean, it was massive, and you could never see something like that happening before. I mean, I'd love to see it, but it would never happen in this day and age, simply because the show just isn't big enough. But what did you make of Cameron going to Africa when it first happened?
I think it's a very good twist. I think it was a smart idea to link the shows with other things. I mean, I see people saying, how would it work these days if you swapped with America? America wouldn't touch us these days.
No, that would not happen. That would not happen because the formats are too different. I could see it happening with the Australian version, but it would never happen with one of the ones that's kind of like the tactical thing, because it would just, the shows are just completely different shows.
I mean, could you imagine Winston in Big Brother America?
we'll give you Winston. We can have Zach.
We're gonna turn on him, yeah, right? Yeah, yeah. Him talking tactics.
Then just withdraw his passport. without anyone knowing. Just be like, sorry, you can't come back. Whoops.
But it was amazing as well that, like, there was this, like, it was for like the young innocent maid to see there was this big brother outside of Britain, and like to see how the Africans did it, because I think they actually showed episodes of the African version when Cameron was in there. They showed their episodes. It was just amazing to see this sort of entirely different culture that was happening. And of course, as well, we had Gaetano, who was the other part of the twist. He went over to the UK.
I think he was a bit overwhelmed by the UK. I don't think he really made much of an impact. I think we gave them Cameron. We got just no one, really. We might as well have just given them Cameron for a week. But he was a nice enough guy, but he just didn't really...
There were two big things about Gaetano that really stood out for me. The first one was, I remember when he actually came into the show, everyone was saying hello to him, how are you, etc., etc. First thing he says was, can someone please tell me where the bathroom is? I've got to take a dump. Which is almost like him symbolically saying, yeah, this is just a lord. I'm just getting out of here straight away.
Charlotte Crosby number two.
Yeah, it was a neat idea to do. It was a gimmick, and they never did it again, really. So, again, I think if you did it with an English-speaking country, it would work if you kind of cross-promoted the shows with, like, the Australian version and stuff. Especially since they're so close in format and ideas nowadays. I think definitely the us and the Australian version have always been very similar. I think that could work. With this one, it was a neat idea, but at the end of the day, you're going to get one person who doesn't really speak the language. And that's going to be a hindrance to the show, because he's not going to be able to... Even if he does speak, you know, good enough English, there's still going to be that language barrier then, socially. And the whole show is based on social interaction, so... Yep.
I think it was more of a gimmick.
Yeah.
Oh, it was
a gimmick. Yeah, which is why I'm saying I think if they did it as a gimmick with an English-speaking country, I think it'd work a hell of a lot better.
And the other thing that Gaetano did is something that links us onto our next point, which is that when Gaetano was in the house, he made comments about Tanya, where he described her as piggy because she ate so much food around the house. And this just completely causes Tanya to absolutely flip off. She's crying about it. She's threatening to leave the house. And this is basically our chance to talk about Tanya's meltdown, which was like the last big dramatic moment of the series, to be honest.
Mm. Well, you know, I could see why she got upset. Sounds like she overreacted a bit, but...
Mm. That's pretty much what I'm going to be saying for the rest of the episode. Mm.
Mm. Sounds like a thing that happened.
And of course, we get that big Tanya meltdown. We get one of the big prominent moments that she has during the show. And of course, she ends up being evicted that week. It's Nush versus Steph versus Tanya. Tanya ends up going pretty much unanimously. And this is our chance to talk about it, because what's quite interesting about Tanya looking at her biography, especially in the time in the house, is that you look at her, she was like a footballer's wife, she'd done the glamour modelling shoot, she'd been involved with Dave Bowers, and you'd think, if that type of housemate was in Big Brother now, how hated would she be? And yet she was just treated as just the same nice, normal figure as what the rest of the Big Brother forecast was. She would be villainized in this day and age.
Because she'd already had a media background, yeah.
Associated with Dane Bowers, that's something that we haven't seen in recent years, is it?
It would have been plastered on front of the day, on front of one of the papers, you know, Dane Bowers' ex-lover.
I mean, what I've been told by people that have been to launch nights every year, Dane Bowers goes whether he knows anyone in the house or not. He seriously, they invite him and he goes every launch night.
You got anything better to do?
With him, yeah, he's serious. I mean, everyone was like, oh look, there's Dave Bowers, and then my friend turned around and went, yeah, he's here every year. He's just a regular, apparently, just standing there in the stands, even if he knows not one person going in the house. This year he knew one person going in the house and they couldn't remember his name. His face just dropped.
It gets even better though when the other person that Tanya had a relationship with was Peter Andre. Peter on Dane Bowers.
Well, almost kind
Why
of...
Why didn't she win?
Yeah, Jesus Christ. She got there first. The original version.
Move along, Pricey. Has she got a secret relationship with a crossdresser in there?
MMA wasn't that big.
Sounds about accurate.
MMA wasn't that big back then, so it was probably a wrestler or something.
Yeah. And that's all that we can really say about Tanya. So, of course...
She shagged Dane Bowers.
She shagged Dane Bowers and Peter Andre. Just like every other celebrity housemate that there's been.
Yeah.
Although, to be completely honest with you, that's probably the most interesting thing we've said all podcast. Is
yes, yes it is.
Just interesting.
Now you know.
So we go on to week 6 now, and it's getting really obvious that the production team are getting a bit desperate about how poor Big Brother 4's getting. So they used the first really manipulated twist probably in the Big Brother franchise's history, which was the introduction of Lisa James.
Yeah. And she was a bit of a bitch.
Yeah. But that sounds like it happened.
Well, yeah. Well, I think Lisa gets a bit of a bad rap, though, because I think if you actually look back on the series now and you see, especially the time that Lisa was there, Lisa was certainly a step up from the Big Brother 4 housemates. Maybe that doesn't make her a great housemate, but it certainly she was a lot better than what she had. And the other thing I really remember as well from her coming in was, I don't know why this always really stuck with me, was they introduced her as part of the reward room task, and the idea was that all the housemates had to pull straws. The person who got the short straw ended up not having to go in. So everyone's pulling out the long straws, and it comes to Goss, he's the last person there. And Goss has mentally got in his head, I've got the short straw, pulls it out, it's the same length as everyone else. He's going absolutely berserk, he's celebrating out it, and he runs over into the reward room, and he's just like, oh my god, there's a new person!
I mean, that says a lot, doesn't it?
Yes, I'm stretching, to be honest, trying to get something, but... I was happy to see Lisa there, and she definitely seemed something different. And there are so many stories as well that surrounded Lisa as well, because the one that really the press really ran with was the story that she was a man.
Really? Which, again, foreshadowing. Almost as if the next year was a deliberate casting stunt.
But Lisa almost immediately makes an impact, which comes in the Gymkhana task, which was... basically, them jumping over hurdles, having to rehearse it, very much like the whole show jumping thing. And Lisa has this massive panic attack. She can't breathe very well, and she has to be basically on medical grounds, pulled out of the task. And it brings out a really nasty side to Cameron. And I don't think Cameron gets a really bad... I don't think Cameron gets a good rap on any of the social media forums. And I think a lot of it stems from this, because his rant about Lisa in the diary room was very, very out there. I think especially since the show was trying to pay Cameron as the good, wholesome, Christian, Scottish boy, to see him making threats about what he would do to Lisa if she had another panic attack or started whinging, it caught me off guard. Because didn't he say something like he would clog up a windpipe or something like that?
Oh, God. Wow. Yeah, I was going to say, I only ever remember him as kind of the mild-mannered guy. I don't remember this at all.
There was a really dark side to him as well. And I think especially as well, when you add that to the control he had over the majority of the house, because a lot of people on the social media forums have painted this idea that Cameron and Steph basically had this power block fort where anybody who wanted to cause any sort of entertainment factor were ostracized and forced out of the house because they wanted to keep the happy family together. And another exciting thing came from the bomb scare that happened. Now, that eviction that week was going to be Goss versus Nush versus Ray. But on the Friday of the eviction, they had to evacuate the house because there'd been threat of a bomb being planted there.
So somebody was like, Jesus Christ, this show's boring. Wrangle, it's a bomb!
I mean, yeah. That's probably the most interesting thing about that whole series.
Yeah, oh my God. Somebody was so bored that they decided they were going to be a terrorist for the day. They were willing to go to prison to make this show better.
Was it right?
Devoted fan base.
Yes.
I could probably name about 5 people on social media these days who would kill to do that for the series these days. And apparently, according to the book, bring the book back up, It says they were taken to a cafe outside the studio. They were told there was going to be no eviction, and Goss celebrated by battering a Ben and Jerry's freezer.
Well, how's Mitch going to a cafe? How much would the fan base have kicked off about that these days?
They're in a cafe! They're eating food! They're drinking coffee! Bring down
Charlie! You should have let them blow up, goddammit! You should have been left there to blow up. It's the purity of the show.
I can't help but think that probably would have actually been the case. They would have kicked off. This is a social experiment. You should have left them there. How dare you remove them?
Bombs are part of life. It's a task.
If we had life, this wouldn't have happened.
You should have made a task to disarm the bomb.
But let me guess, if they'd have failed, they still would have got a takeaway. I'd love to see something like that in modern day terms.
My god, imagine if they actually did a pretend one. Nobody would believe it, but if they had an actual task where they tell the housemates, no, there's a live bomb in the back garden and you've got to disarm it, and if you fail it will explode. Nobody would believe them, but it'd be amazing. They'd be that one dumbass from Essex who'd be like, oh my god, it's a real bomb.
Let's just put Winston in a house with a bomb and just see if he can disarm it. I'm not suggesting that we blow up Winston. I'm just saying that it would be quite funny to see him trying to disarm a bomb.
Yeah.
I am not promoting any sort of bomb-related activity here, except it would be quite funny if they did a fake bomb scare.
Yeah, we probably shouldn't be promoting the idea of having any sort of bomb thing on Skype, in case we're being listened to. We're joking!
On that note, we'll move on. So, of course, that eviction ends up being cancelled. They just run the show with archive footage, because, obviously, they've had to evacuate all the cameramen as well. So, the housemates all go in, and the day after, the eviction takes place. And unsurprisingly, it ends up being Goss who ends up going that week. And Goss actually has to leave the house to no audience whatsoever. And there's only ever been two housemates that have ever had a proper eviction to no audience. Goss and Jade Goody.
Oh.
And that's the only time you'll ever see them two on the same pedestal.
Wow. One person because of a bomb scare and the other person because of death threats. So
they're quite similar, aren't they?
Yeah.
Now that you mention it, there's another thing that we can link Jay Goody and Goss to. I think we're going to be hearing a lot more of them too.
Well, probably not the former.
And on that note,
well, I hope.
And on that note, we get the chance to talk about Goss, because, look, every housemate in that Big Brother 4 has ended up getting a lot of grief for how boring they were. And yet, I don't know why, but Goss seems to have got it even more than everybody else. I mean, I remember seeing a poll after, I think it was Big Brother 6, when they were doing the fan polls, and Goss was voted as the worst housemate ever. And yet, when you watch him during that season, he's no worse than any of the other housemates during that season. And I wonder why it was specifically that Goss ended up getting
If you left that poll about 5 more years, he wouldn't have been, that's for sure. There was people there's people later on who literally went in there for 2 minutes and left.
I've got a bit of a theory on why I think Goss got so much grief, and I'm probably opening a can of worms. Do you think the fact that he was a big bloke and there were all these connotations that being big meant you were lazy and you were inactive, and he got tired with it more than what maybe the other housemates did because he was a big bloke?
Look at you channeling your inner Katie Hopkins.
Well, no, I'm not criticizing him for being fat, because I've got a bit of a Michelin man thing going on myself, but. I just know how the audience works on these sort of shows sometimes, and just I sort of fear that's why he got unfairly tarred.
Maybe.
Because he was a nice enough bloke. I mean, Goss is the sort of person who you would love to hang around with, you would love to have as your friend, but just doesn't
Isn't that this cast?
It's pretty much, yeah.
It's the people you'd love to live with, but not to watch on TV.
I think that's what I think there's not many series where you can say that.
That is literally the caption of this series.
Now we move on to week 7, and we get something else which is quite unique as well, which is Big Brother UK gets its first ever head of house. Rhea wins a task which I think involves wind-up toys. I think they actually borrowed that out of Friends. I think Friends did something similar where they just had a wind-up toy race, and Rhea ends up winning, and he ends up becoming Big Brother's first ever head of the house. What did you make of that?
It's a cool thing to do something different. Whenever they try and do this, I'm always like, it doesn't work, because you don't get any of the power that comes with that in the American version. So without the power, it's just a meaningless title and a fancy room and a couple of rewards.
It was definitely something different, though.
It was, but again, it means nothing. It's just a status and a few extra chocolates.
But in the Big Brother house, that pretty much is what everyone's fighting for, just the name.
I think if they made somebody actually, you know, have power, that means that, you know, over evictions and stuff, I think that's more important.
And I think as well, the other thing that this really coincided with as well was, obviously, because the show's getting desperate to have anything happening, they really try and push the idea of Rhea as being the big fun time character of the show. He becomes quite prominent from this point on, in my opinion.
Hmm.
Is that name again? No. Yeah. I think... Yeah.
Was he not that Ghostbuster who made the Marshmallow Man? I remember, yeah.
Good old Ray.
And the other big thing the production team try and push as well from that week is Nush and Scott as a showmans. Because, I mean, they really start to go heavy on trying to get them two together. And there's something that happens in week 8 that's pretty much the epitome of that. What did you make of that, though? Did you think there was anything there between the two? Or do you think it was just production being that desperate they'll throw anything at the wall?
The production wanted something to put in the highlight show. I think that's about it. Because at this minute in time, they're one of the highlights is them cooking breakfast, I think.
I actually remember one of the highlights show, because I think they were on about 45 minutes at that point. They actually had to drop it to half an hour because it was that little on there. And one of the stories...
Imagine if that happened these days. Sorry, I keep saying that.
What, the
fans, why aren't you doing anything?
One of the highlights I remember, I actually remember this from an episode, one of the highlight clips was Steph hoovering up.
Oh my god.
That's how bad it got around the stage.
I'm quite amused that Stephanie's sitting there hoovering up, and that's made the highlight show. I think, and as I will show you in my minute montage of what happened that series, I think that says a lot.
Well, maybe if we did that on November 11th, that'd be the minute montage.
And of course, things get worse when we end up losing Lisa James that week. It's Lisa versus Cameron versus Steph. Lisa inevitably ends up being evicted because she's the only one doing anything. This is our chance to talk about Lisa James, because what's quite interesting as well is that Lisa, I remember when they did Ultimate Big Brother, and Ultimate Big Brother was basically a celebration of all things of the Channel 4 era. Lisa was the only Big Brother 4 cast member that came back for it.
Yeah.
Yeah, because John was probably not very interested, and anybody remembered, really.
The rest of them, they just forgot their names. It's pretty much like Destiny's Child. You've got Beyonce, Kelly Rowland, and the other one. I think that's pretty much...
Sabrina?
I know her name. I know her name, but it's just... That's pretty much what the producers were probably thinking. Yeah, we've either got John Tickle or Lisa James.
There were so many people left out from so many good series in that thing. I really was not pining for any of these fuckers.
We're in a series where Brian Bellow didn't even make the lineup. I mean, as much as people dislike Brian Bellow, he added a lot more than Lisa Jane probably did.
Lisa though did give us that brilliant comment, though. I think she'd had some sort of confrontation with Cameron, and she said, I could kill someone with these two fingers. And that sort of became sort of, it would be almost like mimic these days.
that was pretty much one of the quotes that Big Brother focused on when
it
ended.
The season.
I mean the actual Big Brother ending on Channel 4. That was one of the main quotes that they pushed, was that, and probably I think the East Anglia thing was one of the quotes, and obviously if you live by the sword, you die by the sword. But I think that's the only thing that came out of Big Brother 4.
I'll kill you with two fingers. That's the other one.
Yeah. I think that's what most people were wanting to do with Big Brother 4 at this point.
What, kill it with two fingers?
Yes. Or maybe just
I don't think it would really take two fingers to kill it. I think it would take the little finger to kill it.
What, to turn the rookie TV off, yeah.
Don't get too far ahead of yourselves, lad. You would have missed the girls' night in. If you want almost a representation of just how badly things went wrong for Big Brother 4, this is it. Because we already touched on the fact that Mitch and Scott, as a showman, was really beginning to build up steam. It was the one thing the production were really trying to run for. So they come up with this idea that they're going to do this romantic evening and for Scott and Nush. So they do up the reward room, so it's like got loads of flowers everywhere, it's painted pink, it's like, so it's like a old hotel room and they're going to watch like romantic films, so they're really going all out for it, okay? And there's going to be a competition to see which two people are going to go into the reward room. So obviously, you do all that preparation, it's going to be Scott and Nush. Who wins it? Ray and Cameron.
Lads not in. Lads on tour.
So of course they're there painting their fingernails and they're having to watch Bridget Jones's Diary and
I mean on Channel 5 these days they'd probably go, no, they didn't win it, they cheated in some way. Stephen and Kimberly in the reward room.
Well, there wouldn't even be like a random competition, they would just flat out blatantly rig it like they did with Daily and Hazel.
Poor Daily and Hazel. That, I mean, says a lot when the most boring housemate ends up getting ejected for being a bit out of control. And don't anyone dare say that my Sophie was boring. I mean, she was, but still.
But of course, production right now, they're getting so desperate. I mean, they are really chucking everything at the wall. And it's another example of one of those things that the franchise would just absolutely hate these days. Things get so bad, they do the photo return.
Yeah.
All the evictees are all gathered outside the house and they all say that one of them will re-enter the house, not to win the show, but they will go back in as a guest.
So that's the difference between this and the 7-1, which was such a controversy.
Yes.
Because the 7-1 was you could win.
Yes, it's essentially.
Oh. But at least with the 7-1, we actually got someone back that shouldn't have been evicted. Although with Big Brother 4, that happened as well.
Although she was never the same, of course. But that's a conversation we've had on the other show.
Well, who was she?
Nikki.
Yeah.
I think. He knew.
Oh, I get what you were saying. Okay, yeah, yeah, okay.
But John ends up absolutely destroying everyone in that vote. I'll see if there's any. Yeah, 62% of people wanted John Tingle to return. What was quite interesting, though, was the person who was second was Lisa Jones, who had just been evicted
the
one day
remembered.
Before.
It was like, oh, she did something.
But I just find it so funny, though, that Lisa ends up getting evicted, 82%. They do a vote to return, and most people want her back again.
Because they're bored. They realise they made a mistake.
And what did you think of John Tickle as a returnee? Did you feel he really delivered in that regard?
I think he's obviously the wrong guy for the job because he's never going to be, you know, this fake, malicious person. You know, he's not Mikosi.
Who do you think would have been perfect for it from that cast then?
Lisa. Or at least put someone in that we know could have been amusing. Was Anushka back from Australia, by the way?
I don't think so. I think she was in Australia at that point because she would have been perfect for it.
Yeah, but obviously Anushka, she was too busy in Australia. So yeah, I think
making their show better. Yeah, thanks.
I know. Story of our lives.
So yeah, we end up getting John back and not much else from it. And we end up getting a one-on-one Nush versus Cameron eviction, and it's Nush that ends up going, which, again, not really a surprise, because I think most people had it down Cameron was going to win the show by this point.
Mm.
Yeah, but that's hardly saying a lot, is it? That Cameron's the only one that could possibly win it, because everyone else was just half dead.
Or there. They were just there. They live there. They woke up that day.
They existed.
Yeah.
Did they? I wouldn't go that far.
And what did you make of Nush as a person? Again, very similar to the rest of the housemates. Perfectly pleasant, nice enough girl, but not great television.
Yeah.
Yep.
There you go. That's my opinion. Yeah.
We are really struggling. We're really struggling to get to the end here, because I have to be honest, I write down a couple of discussion notes on what we could possibly talk about around Big Brother 4. And for the final week, I haven't got anything, because there was just nothing that happened in the final week to talk about.
Except for, it was the final!
Yay, Cameron won! Yay, good for him.
Yay, champagne! That's about the most interesting thing that happened. I mean, for a group that spent... You ready for another one of my stats? For a group that spent a third of their budget on alcohol in the first week, they were quite boring, weren't they?
You're telling me? I watched it.
I didn't. I did a bit. But then I just pretty much catched up on everything else. I've somehow managed to make my way through this whole show.
Honestly, if you rewatched Big Brother 4 now and you fast-forwarded all the boring bits, the whole thing would take about, what, an hour and a half?
10 minutes.
I mean, yeah, that's pretty much it. Oh, we've got comments on Justine, by the way. I posted on TIBB.
Oh, cool. What have we got?
We've got posts. Right, you ready for this? I said, odd question. I'm currently recording the podcast about Big Brother 4. Anyone have any anything interesting to say about Justine? Or any opinions on Big Brother 4? Amy Jade said the only housemates worth mentioning are Tanya and Federico. And then someone else thought this was about goddess Justine Littlewood, whoever she is. I had to Google to remember her. I think I liked her from Natalie. And Kazar said, or Quasar or whatever, I remember liking her, but I didn't watch Big Brother 4 much. So I think that says a lot about
Big Brother 4. That is a success.
Look, people, I promise. We promise we'll rewatch number 3, because I actually want to rewatch 3 because it was a good one. So
you see, I'm quite excited to discuss Hijack.
Yes.
I mean,
yes.
That's coming up. We were going to try and get it done before the series, but then Channel 5 decided to give us 2 weeks' notice of a new series. But yeah, I think, despite the fact people say Hijack was boring, I think there's a lot more to discuss in Hijack than Big Brother 4.
So on that note, we'll begin wrapping.
Can
up.
Can I do my montage?
Yes, you can.
Big Brother. These are things that the official Big Brother 4 book voted as the highlights of the series. Right. Day 22, it's a baking hot day in the Big Brother house. Day 25, they decided to do a double eviction.
Mm.
Day 28, ends in a row. Day 31, Cameron waited in the reward room for 25 minutes. Day 33, it's a slow and lazy start in the house. Day 35, the housemates were rewarded with a fry-up.
Mm-hmm.
Day 36, Cameron returned to the house. Day 37, there were 7 new chickens. Day 42, it's Thursday, the weekly day off. Everyone sleeps late. Day 43, it starts normally enough. Day 46, there's an early start and everyone dances to S Club 7. week 8, day 57, John tries to take control of the world. Day 60, another slow day. another slow and lazy day. Day 64, it's the final. At the conclusion of the whole series, the actual quote, it's over. Nine fantastic, frantic weeks have finally drawn to a close. This is from the official book. And another quote, right? Day 50, one of the most dramatic days of in the history of Big Brother. Tension. Lisa says something. No one holds hands.
God, how dare
so
they?
I spent 2 months of my childhood watching that.
God.
They were the actual highlights that the Big Brother official book, they actually published this for £9.99.
Oh my God.
That's all I could say was that there were seven new chickens and that it was a slow and lazy start in the house.
Oh my Lord.
And that it was the weekly day off.
Folks, I moan about the Channel 5 production a lot on this show. Believe me, I do. But you take away all the stuff from the latest Channel 4, you take away casting, you take away manipulation, you take away Evil Big Brother, you take away tasks and things like that, and twists and turns and all that kind of stuff. Yes, they overdo it these days, and I do like it, you know, more kind of how it was, you know, 5 or 6 years ago. But without all those things, you get this series.
Do you think it's even worth us talking about the Final Four?
No.
No!
Because you're going to say three names that I don't remember, and Cameron.
You might as well have just said, is it worth discussing this whole series?
We may as well have just come on and gone, four happened, it was really fucking boring.
Cameron won!
See you next time for Big Brother 3.
I know. Is that the next one we're doing?
Yeah, we're going backwards, unfortunately. We've already spoke about all the good ones.
I think it is worth us talking about Cameron, though, because Cameron, of course, ended up winning the season. And yet, amazingly, though, for all these faults, I don't think he's the worst winner ever.
No.
Who is?
Hellbeast.
Well, yeah, but that's hardly saying a lot, is it?
Yeah, but at least she did stuff.
Kate Marsh would have been a better winning than Helen.
It's that whole argument of, she added entertainment and actually did stuff in the show, but at the same time, do you deserve to reward somebody like that with money? And yeah, whereas at least this time it went to a nice guy.
And Cameron, yeah, he had faults.
We're in Scotland.
He had faults. Look, Cameron had faults. He wasn't exciting. He did have a nasty side to him, but he was decent enough. I've seen worse people than Cameron in the world, and I do feel that someone like that getting sort of money, I don't have a problem with. I just wish he'd been a bit more entertaining to do it, because this is an entertainment show.
I mean, Frank, the American series lasted until the Final Five, so Cameron might as well have been the best winner of Big Brother UK ever, and it wouldn't have been any less of a justice.
And I think it's quite... I'm wondering if it's worth asking this question. What did you think of Big Brother 4?
I thought it was the best series we've ever had from... the UK, and I wish we'd have another one like it. Because
these are the dates we need to go back to. You know, fuck the 5-7 era. It had nothing on this.
Yeah, I mean, people moan about Big Brother 7 being too dramatic, but when you've got a series like this, Big Brother 7 is the most boring shit on earth.
Mm-hmm. We want more of Steph staring into the distance, goddammit.
Yeah. Yeah.
We want more of Steph doing the hoovering. So much better than Nikki sitting in a diary room chair moaning about an MP3 player.
Yeah, God.
It was very telling as well, because I think everybody just knew Big Brother 4 was a dud. We don't want to talk about it. We're not going to mention it again. It's the Star Wars holiday special of the Big Brother podcast.
It's the Family Guy Star Wars specials. You might as well just not watch.
No. This would be the equivalent of the Star Wars if there was like a wall that had Star Wars painted on it that was drying. That's what this is.
And it was very telling as well, the reaction from, especially from Channel 4's point of view afterwards, because I remember one of the things I will give Big Brother 4 for was it introduced me to another world of Big Brother, because not only did we get clips of the African version when Cameron was there, but Channel 4 obviously knew the series had failed. And almost as this sort of apology, they started showing the American version on E4. They actually did a delayed live feed, so you could actually watch it almost in real time. So when it was 3 o'clock in America, it was 3 o'clock over here. And seeing this world of Big Brother 4 where we're having like June and Alison completely manipulating the house and this completely new side of Big Brother, I actually thank Big Brother 4 for getting me interested in the American version.
It's not like the equivalent of when you're bored with WWE, so it's like, oh, thank you for being so shit, WWE, because you made me discover TNA or something like that.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah. That's the only positive I can think of that came out of Big Brother 4 from my personal perspective. But, again, that's not saying much yet. Because, honestly, we have really struggled to try and get something out of this episode.
I mean, I think I'm going to be a bit out of touch with the Karls here. But in terms of Disney films, this is the home on the range of Big Brother. Just, you might as well just skip past it and pretend it didn't happen. As far as I'm concerned, it's just another number. This episode, I think, has showed. I mean, I've had a lot of fun discussing it, and I've had a lot of fun sitting here talking about Federico getting warnings and it being
You know what, Mitchell? I wish you had been here when we were discussing the series we liked. I mean, it's going to be fun going back to the original ones, but I think a lot of...
I'm quite annoyed that you did Celebrity Big Brother 15 without me. I wish I had a team there, because I had so much it was unreal.
We've got the modern series to talk about, obviously, but, I mean, 1 to 3, it's this really interesting series, because they're remembered fondly because of what they were for the time. I don't know how well they're going to hold up now compared to some of the series we've had since.
And I mean, Big Brother 1 was hardly that interesting, but at least you had something.
No, but it was this brand new thing, and the novelty of it was the concept.
I mean, I watched Big Brother, the first ever Big Brother episode the other day, and it dragged. I enjoyed it because it was Big Brother, and because it was interesting seeing how, Marcus Bentley when he didn't have that Geordie of an accent. But it was just an interesting thing, and I don't think I've seen so many boobs, bums, and penises in my life. Than that first episode. But it just shows you how different the show was then to what we get now.
Yeah. And it's something that we're really going to be looking forward to exploring, that sort of like golden age of the show when we talk about 1 to 3. And that brings us on to the next series that we'll be covering, which will be Big Brother 3, which is one which I think we're really looking forward to. Because you mentioned, how well does it hold up? Is it still the classic golden series that a lot of people made it out to be back in 2002?
But obviously, we'll leave that for another time.
Yes. The other thing we want to bring up as well is that Mitchell sort of mentioned it there, which was when we did the Big Brother 9 podcast years and years, yonks ago. One of the things we said was, if the man was there for us to do Celebrity Hijack, we'd do it. That's still up on the table, because Mitchell's a big advocate of that series, and he mentioned he would love to talk about it. So if there is anybody who is listening to this, if you want us to talk about Hijack, please get us in touch, and we'll look to try and do it as soon as
possible. I'd have to watch it.
I've got a feeling that you advertised this on the wrong series, on the wrong series recap. Yeah, if anyone's still listening to us talking about Big Brother 4, then if you fancy us doing one on Hijack, carry on.
I'd have to watch it. I've never seen it before.
You won't be disappointed. It's one I quite enjoy as well. But until that point, we are going to leave it there. We have spent 2 hours talking about...
How the hell have we done this? I guarantee if you take out us bitching about Channel 5 or irrelevant comments, it'd be about 10 minutes.
So on that note, we're going to be ending this on a high then. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for staying with us throughout the entire show. You are really devoted Big Brother fans for doing
so. Can I add something quickly?
Yes?
If you've got anything to say, about what we've discussed now, leave it in the comments or tweet us at Big Archive. We're going to start becoming quite prominent on Twitter, I hope. So tweet us and we'll always reply.
Absolutely, we need to get out there. And if you you are the person who thinks that this is the best series there ever was, we want you on to tell us why.
And if you are Justine Selman and you just haven't stumbled across this episode, please get in contact.
Tell us why we should remember you.
We'd really like to speak to you.
Are you in fact the most attractive
I would love to see you on this podcast. We will do a special, especially for you. We will do the Justine Spellman edition.
We'll get her to tell us what happened in the series.
It'll be another Big Brother 4. We'll all be sitting there going, yeah, that sounds interesting. Yeah, that happened. But yeah, if you're out there, Justine, please make yourself stand out because we would love to speak to you.
And on that note,
anyone really. I don't think we're very picky. I don't think we only want to speak to Justine Selman. If anyone's out there that wants to speak to us, we'll have you. Unless you're a hell bitch.
And on that threat, it is time to end the show. Thank you very much for joining us. You've been really devoted for listening to us. This has been Big Brother's Big Archive. My name's been Karl Birbridge. That's been Karl Dutton.
Channel 5. Fuck you.
That's been Mitchell Pinder.
Sissy!
And we'll see you again soon for Big Brother 3 or Hijack. Bye bye for now.